At an event celebrating Operation Warp Speed, Trump credited his administration with producing vaccines more rapidly than has ever been done before.
Today, we're on the verge of another American medical miracle. And that's what people are saying. People that aren't necessarily big fans of Donald Trump are saying, whether you like him or not, this is one of the greatest miracles in the history of modern day medicine.
He said that the Food and Drug Administration would likely authorize the BioNTech-Pfizer vaccine within days and the Moderna vaccine soon after. Officials from Biden's transition team, who will oversee the bulk of the vaccination rollout, were not invited. Instead, Biden held his own parallel event. He introduced his new pandemic response team and laid out his top priorities for the start of his tenure.
Masking, vaccinations, opening schools. These are the three key goals for my first 100 days.
Like Trump, Biden made promises about getting Americans vaccinated quickly.
This team will help get at the last 100 million COVID-19 vaccine, at least 100 million COVID vaccine shots into the arms of the American people in the first 100 days. 100 million shots in the first 100 days.
But Biden warned that without funding from Congress, vaccination efforts could quickly stall.
Developing a vaccine is only one Herculean task. Distributing it is another Herculean task.
He also said that getting kids back to school was a major priority and that he'd mandate a mask requirement in federal buildings and on public transportation on day one of taking office.
My first 100 days won't end the COVID-19 virus. I can't promise that, but I'm absolutely convinced that in 100 days we can change the course of the disease and change life in America for the better.
Both sides of the aisle appear to be throwing their weight behind what could soon become the biggest vaccination effort in the nation's history.
Let's take a look now at some other developments in the pandemic. Israel received its first shipment of coronavirus vaccines on Wednesday. The country is expected to receive enough vaccine for about a quarter of the population by the end of the year. And Israel plans to start administering the vaccines on December 20th. China has tested more than a quarter of a million people for COVID-19 after a handful of new cases were detected in the southern city of Chengdu. And South Korea reported 686 new coronavirus cases on Wednesday as it battles a third wave of infection that is threatening to overwhelm the health system. The daily tally is the second highest since the start of the pandemic. And coronavirus numbers are climbing in Turkey, which now ranks fourth globally in the highest number of daily cases. Doctors there are sounding the alarm. After months of pressure by health experts and opposition politicians, the government has reintroduced stricter rules to contain the pandemic. DW's Yulia Han has more.
Iris is celebrating her birthday. She turns 8 today. Her two biggest wishes, a Harry Potter cake and meeting her best friends. The latter is more difficult to organize since stricter coronavirus measures have come into force in Turkey. Young people under the age of 20 are only allowed to leave their homes for 3 hours a day. I used to be able to go outside whenever I wanted. That was much better. I also miss school. Now everything is done via Zoom, and it's so annoying. Iris's mother is trying to organize life as best as she can between work and curfew. She's often surprised how quickly the children have adapted to the difficult situation. The kids wear their masks without complaining, even when they're playing. They got used to it. Only when we look at old photos do we notice that the masks weren't always there. Curfews for children are not the only new anti-coronavirus rule in Turkey. Those older than 65 can also only go outside at certain times. Public transportation is forbidden for young and old people. And on weekends, everyone, with few exceptions, has to stay at home. It looks pretty bleak these days in Istanbul's usually very busy neighborhoods. Restaurants, bars, many shops closed.
Until recently, the Turkish government only published the number of COVID-19 patients showing clear symptoms. And that's why many people here thought Turkey was surviving the crisis relatively well. But now the authorities have started to release data on the number of all new infections every day. And many are realizing Turkey is one of the worst affected countries in the world.
The government now reports about 30,000 new infections per day. Many of us are angry about how the government is managing the crisis, but there is nothing we can do. The government is concerned with its reputation. They want to look good. That is why there is no transparency. They should have informed people much better right from the beginning. Then everyone would have known what to expect and how to act. Emrah Kırımlı deals with many COVID-19 patients. He's a family doctor and belongs to the Turkish Medical Association. He says the authorities are still hiding the true extent of the crisis. We still have a lot more cases than the government says. According to our estimates, we have about 50,000 to 60,000 new infections per day. Our doctors and hospitals are at the absolute limit. We have to urgently take radical countermeasures. Iris thinks the current restrictions are already plenty tough. Her party is over. The kids have to go back inside. Next year, she hopes for a birthday without the coronavirus.
That report there from our correspondent Yulia Han in Istanbul, and she's standing by for us with more on the story. Hi, Yulia, good to see you. Can you explain to us why Turkey has different restrictions for the young and also for the old? Yulia, can you hear us?
Yeah, ich höre dich.
All right, it looks like we're having some trouble with Yulia Han's line there. Yulia, can you hear us? I'll try one more time here.
I can hear you now.
Okay, Yulia, we were just taking a look at your report, and I wanted to know if you could explain to us why there are different restrictions in Turkey for the young and for the old.
Well, the Turkish government first introduced stay-at-home orders for those aged 65 and older and those aged 20 or younger in April when the pandemic started, basically arguing that the elderly are a risk group that needs protection while asymptomatic young people might fuel the spread of the virus. Now, both age groups combined make up about 40% of the Turkish population. And since most of them are not part of the workforce, keeping them at home, and that's certainly part of the reasoning here, is less harmful to the economy than, let's say, similar measures targeted at the working population. In spring, though, the curfews were much tougher. The young and the elderly were completely banned from leaving their homes for about 2 months, and the authorities argued that this helped bring the numbers down. So what we're seeing now is somehow a softer version of the curfews we saw earlier this year, while the overall coronavirus situation here in Turkey is much worse than it was in spring.
You mentioned in your report, Yulia, the discrepancies between how Turkey has been reporting new COVID-19 infections. So how clear is the picture there of the situation right now?
Well, my impression is that the pandemic here in Turkey risks spiraling out of control. Many people we speak to either know someone who tested positive for COVID-19 or someone who even died from the virus. Now, we have the official figures published by the Turkish Health Ministry, and according to this, we had more than 33,000 new infections in the last 24 hours. That's the highest number reported since the beginning of the pandemic. It's also the highest number in Europe right now. The official death rate has also more than doubled in less than 3 weeks. Now, these figures are already very alarming. If you now listen to what the Turkish Medical Association says, and it represents most of the country's doctors, the actual figures are even higher. And now add to this their warning. Some say it's actually a cry for help that hospitals are full, that ICUs are full, especially here in Istanbul. All of this is painting a very grim picture.
Given that alarming situation, Yulia, do you think that the current measures that are in place are enough to curb the spread?
Well, the Turkish Medical Association, the doctor we spoke to for the report, clearly say no. They say in a city like Istanbul, with 16 million people, you would actually need to shut everything down for at least 14 days to relax the situation in the hospitals at least a little. I don't think we're going to see anything like this, because the government already said that they want to avoid any additional economic pain. But the government now is being criticized a lot for their lack of transparency, for giving the economy a priority in this health crisis, and for acting too little, too late.
DW's Julia Han in Istanbul for us. Thank you very much.